Good evening. Our first day of lockdown 5 has come with fresh proof the raging Delta variant is spreading among strangers at the MCG and at schools. And as Andrew Lund explains, National Cabinet has agreed on the need to drive the number of infectious community cases back to zero.
From the quiet city streets, closed businesses and padlocks to the eerily empty peak hour escalators at Parliament Station, the first day of our fifth lockdown felt very familiar.
It's a bit sombre. We're all a bit sad and a bit over it.
Overnight, Victoria recorded another 6 new cases on top of the 4 announced late yesterday, taking the confirmed total linked to this outbreak to 24. But that number is growing.
It very much, I think, underscores the need to have the lockdown. It very much confirms the decision, as difficult as it was, that we took yesterday.
Today's new cases all stem from the Sydney Removalist cluster. One is a household contact of the Barwon Heads case. 2 are work colleagues from Bacchus Marsh Grammar. And this afternoon, the school notified parents a further 2 teachers have tested positive. 2 other people were exposed at Young and Jackson, and 1 was at Saturday's Carlton Geelong game, bringing to 4 the number of cases now linked to the MCG.
The 4 individuals who I've identified today who are at the MCG, again, they did not know each other. They did not sit directly with each other. They did not know the index case or his friend. And again, we're back in a world of very fleeting transmission occurring in that environment.
There are now more than 125 exposure sites in Victoria, including schools, shops and stadiums.
It will be much more are the people who have become positive that are infected. What was their status? Were they out and about or were they at home? That's why a lockdown's so important.
That approach endorsed this afternoon by National Cabinet.
The target here is to reduce as far as possible to zero the cases that are infectious in the community.
But experts warn the Delta variant is a tough adversary.
It is spread both by droplet and tiny particles called aerosolized or droplet nuclei that hang in the air for longer.
Last night, a few hundred people gathered at State Parliament to protest against the lockdown and vaccinations.
You're bloody ruining it for everyone. You're all going to kill us all. Put your masks back on, you bloody hippies.
As the clock ticked down to midnight, many made the most of bars before they were forced to close. Revelers resigned to spending more time at home.
If you look at New South Wales, they're cooked in.
But it's like, why can't we just stop lockdowns like other countries?
But the Premier hopes his go hard, go early lockdown strategy will avoid a repeat of last year's winter of misery.
We're all working as hard as we possibly can to make this as short a lockdown as possible.
Andrew Lund is in the Bourke Street Mall. Andrew, are Melburnians heeding the call to stay home?
Pete, for the most part, I think it's fair to say they are. You can see the Bourke Street Mall this evening before the tram goes past. It is very empty, the sort of scene you'd expect to see at midnight on a Tuesday rather than just after 6 o'clock on a Friday. But this is the type of thing we've become used to seeing when Melbourne locks down. People are heeding the message to stay home. Of course, one of the reasons to leave home is to get vaccinated. And the state government says an extra 12,000 doses of Pfizer are available over the next 10 days. So now is a good time to get vaccinated if you're eligible. There's also supply of AstraZeneca available, so very worthwhile booking in for an appointment either at a mass vaccination hub or to see your GP. Pete.
Okay, thanks, Andrew Lund. 2 major sporting events are embroiled in the chaos, with parts of Aami Park joining the MCG as an exposure site. HMAS Cerberus has also been forced into lockdown as the list of affected locations balloons. Medical reporter Emily Rice.
When it comes to transmission tactics, the Delta variant plays fast and dirty, spreading asymptomatically and infecting at least 4 strangers at Saturday's Carlton Geelong game.
The 4 individuals who I've identified today who are at the MCG, again, they did not know each other. They did not sit directly with each other. They did not know the index case or his friend.
The Percy Beams Bar on level 2 is now classified as a tier 1 site, meaning anyone who was there between 4 and 4:30pm or 5:20 and 5:50pm must test and isolate for 14 days.
Last year was a lot about mystery cases. Now it's about, you know, fleeting transmission.
Everyone else within the MCC members reserve must also get swabbed and isolate until they get a negative result. Ryan Forsyth was at the game with his 8-year-old daughter.
What I don't get is there's people right next to you. They try and social distance, but there's some in front, some beside.
The sport minister has a different view.
I was at the Carlton Geelong game. There were 32,000 odd and they were spread right around the ground.
One of the infected footy fans, a teacher from Trinity Grammar, also went to the Wallabies game at Aami Park on Wednesday night.
Melbourne have shown up.
Spectators complained of congestion on entry to the stadium, which was deep cleaned today.
If you're at that match, if you have any concerns about your health at all, we want you to go and get tested immediately, please.
Another Melbourne icon, Young and Jackson, remains a hotspot. Of today's new cases, two are young men who met at the pub.
Anybody who was at Young and Jackson's, you know, we have 207 people identified.
And there is a COVID case at the HMAS Cerberus Naval Base. Defence Media says living-in personnel have been confined to their accommodation and takeaway meal services are now being provided.
The public exposure site list is long and varied and includes at least half a dozen opportunity shops, like this one here at Moonee Ponds and one in Sunshine, Bundoora and beyond.
But when it comes to using hard lockdowns to defend against COVID, even the World Health Organization's Professor Dale Fisher says we need a new game plan.
The pandemic's going to go for another 6 months or so. So let's have some tempered measures which are a little bit more predictable rather than the swings of let's open up, let's shut down.
In news just to hand, we've learned of some more school-related COVID cases. Clarendon College in Ballarat has just emailed parents there to say that there is a family member related to a Year 10 and Year 12 student who has tested positive for COVID. And we already know there's one case at Trinity Grammar in Melbourne, and we've heard that there is another individual related to that school. So that brings to Trinity Grammar's caseload to two. We don't know if that's a student or a teacher. That information will be forthcoming over the coming hours or tomorrow. Pete.
Okay, thank you, Emily Rice. Much needed financial support is on the way for staff and businesses crippled by the lockdown. Daniel Andrews and Scott Morrison struck a deal during a late night call, fast tracking cash for those out of work. Mark Santomartino has more.
After bouncing around ideas, the Federal Treasurer has signed off on a deal for lockdown 5.0.
We need to put our hands in our pockets, and that's what we've done from day one.
Daniel Andrews called the Prime Minister last night, promising to cover business support. $201 million has been set aside for $3,000 payments to licensed bars, restaurants, pubs, clubs, hotels and cafes. All other eligible businesses can apply for $2,000 grants.
People will not have to apply. If you got a grant last time, you'll get a grant this time.
But $3,000 won't go far for Johnny Papadimitriou.
It's a drop in the ocean for us. That doesn't even cover our water bill.
Like other Melbourne restaurants, Nikos Cakes is limited to takeaway. And owner Tas Papoutsis is counting the cost of cancelling more than 60 birthday, engagement and wedding cakes.
All these people are ringing us crying. Some people we've had to cancel and move three times. They're giving up. Everyone's giving up.
We don't want to end up like Sydney, but this isn't a solution.
This is not the time for the government to be pinching pennies and being mean to small business.
For Victorian workers like the 100 staff Nikos Cakes has stood down, those that lose more than 20 hours work will be given $600 per week. $375 will be offered to those who lose between 8 and 20 hours, regardless of how much money they have in savings.
You go to my.gov.au to apply, and those payments will then follow.
Just like in New South Wales, the Commonwealth has agreed to foot the bill to support workers in designated hotspots like Melbourne and Greater Geelong, with the state to pay for everyone else.
That's going to be administered by the Commonwealth. I think it would be incredibly difficult if we were trying to run JobKeeper 2.0 and they were running JobKeeper 2.0.
Approximately 22,000 businesses who applied for support during Lockdown 4 are still waiting to hear if they qualify.
We would expect those all to be resolved early next week.
Daniel Andrews, unable to commit to releasing regional Victoria from lockdown early.
It may not be possible. If I don't get advice that says it's safe, then I simply won't do it.
Mark Santomartino, Nine News.
Thousands of Victorian families have returned to remote learning, firing up laptops and transforming the kitchen table into a desk. As Stephanie Anderson explains, we were just 4 days into a new school term when the timetable was thrown out.
Schoolyards are empty and classrooms quiet as more than a million Victorian kids once again switch to their screens.
By this time, I know what to do, so it's easy to transition.
I still haven't had a full term of high school. Each term has had at least 1 week of lockdown.
It's deja vu for many mums and dads too, but fifth time round, remote learning is a well-practiced drill.
By the second, third, fourth, fifth attempt, we get pretty efficient at it.
The official announcement came after the final bell yesterday, so today schools were given flexibility to get their systems in order, many already reading the signs and swinging into action.
It's almost like an evacuation procedure, like, you know, you just sort of click into that mode and away we go.
Even before lockdown, this outbreak has had a real impact on education. Multiple schools are exposure sites, including Bacchus Marsh Grammar, where the gates must stay closed for a full 2 weeks. The same effect being felt at early childhood services across the state.
Now well and truly used to changing and adapting at a moment's notice, schools are at this stage planning to have kids back in the classroom next Wednesday. But like most things right now, it can't yet be guaranteed.
Plan for the best, be prepared for the worst.
Lockdown takes away a lot of the choice that you have, but the one thing that it can't take away is your ability to choose your attitude every day. And I think our children in particular and our teachers have just been amazing.
Stephanie Anderson, Nine News.